you could keep up at a Viking party.
Think again.
Truly.
From complete debauchery to intimate celebrations, we've got all of this on our list of the top 10 unusual things that happened in Viking celebrations.
Should we do this?
Yeah.
Let's do this. Let's dive right in.
At number 10, nonstop party. What is the longest amount of time you've gone out to party? A couple hours, maybe a weekend? Well, I don't think it could ever compare to how long the Vikings partied. The Vikings would have probably had a good old chuckle if they knew our parties only lasted a few hours. They'd be like, ha, look at these weaklings. Anyway, these guys could probably out-party anyone. Their biggest festivities, like the ones held after large expeditions or for weddings, would typically last for days, but their major feasts, like the ones they would use to celebrate the winter solstice, may have lasted upwards of 12 days. Now that's a lot of party stamina. I would probably need about 50 Red Bulls to even try and keep up with these Vikings.
Number 9, actual really good food. Like pretty decent food. If you're a foodie, then I do have some good news for you. The Vikings were apparently like pretty decent cooks. For the time, anyways. They stocked their parties with roasted meats like poultry, horse, and beef, with platters of greens, fruits, and buttered vegetables. Beer, ale, mead, and fruit wines were the common beverages, and heavy drinking was encouraged. Not unlike bars today, where there's always that one person who keeps secretly buying tequila shots for everybody, and then you're like, okay, fine, I'll take it because I don't want to be rude, you know what I mean? Anyways, considering the fact that parties would sometimes last for weeks on end, having a lot of food in their party hut was super important. They needed enough to last them until the partying was done, which who knows when that would be.
At number 8, rap battles. Every party has to have some kind of activity, right? I mean, yeah, we can all stand around listening to music and kikiing it up, but it's way more fun to have activities to participate in, right? Well, the Vikings certainly knew how to throw a party because they had their collection of party activities to choose from, and it sounded kind of like a hoot and a half until we get to the other parts of this list and, you know, just throw that out the window. They would set up games like dice and chess, or at least their early Viking version of chess, and even board games. The Vikings also had this super fun drinking game called Flighting, where partygoers would team up and recite poetry. They would drop some sick bars about their conquests and exploits, and would even drop a diss or two at their opponents. Like a Drake versus Kanye moment. Oh, wait, no, they're friends now. Damn. Well, scratch that last part, but you know what I mean. On top of rap battles and board games, Viking parties just wouldn't be a proper event without drinking, and they even played a game to see who could drink the most. Honestly, I kind of feel bad for the Vikings' livers after all that, and imagine that hangover. Yikes.
Number 7, vicious tunes. Ever had a neighbor who would decide to throw a banger on like a weekday? Or have a roommate who thinks they are really good at guitar and wants to like prove it 24/7? They're like, wow, at like 4 AM? Yeah. It sucks. If you don't enjoy scenarios similar to this, then you would not want to live next door to a Viking encampment. These folks rocked out really hard and for, as we know, a long period of time. They loved live music, as do I, and archaeologists have recovered flutes, hornpipes, and stringed instruments from settlements. But as most of the singers were well into the mead, according to Arab travelers, they weren't easy on the ears? Like, picture the moment Bohemian Rhapsody comes on in a bar and the screeches sounds everyone makes as they try to say Galileo, like really loud. My voice is dead. That would be awful. One account described their singing comparable to the calls of wild animals. Oh boy, that's rough. But sometimes they would switch it up with some poetry, as mentioned, by skilled artists called skalds.
At number 6, full send or no send. It seems like the Vikings lived by the notion full send or no send, because man, did things get wild and crazy at their parties. There was no holding back with these guys. Oh no. I know I previously mentioned some of the activities that the Vikings would have at their parties, but those ones were the tame ones, and if you know the Vikings, they can't have PG friendly shindigs. Of course not. There's gotta be scenes of violence and coarse language. Viewer discretion is advised. Other than playing chess and having rap battles, they also had mass casualties. They played games where people literally kicked the bucket, but I guess dying at a party this wild is a good enough way to go. Some of their more dangerous party activities included throwing leftover bones at one another with the deliberate intent of inflicting bodily harm. They also played a full contact bat and ball game that would often end in injury or the big sleep. And they also held a swimming contest, but there wasn't that much actual swimming involved since the point of the game was to hold their opponent underwater for as long as possible. I would have to imagine that these so-called games would just make for a vicious cycle because they'd celebrate something, play these games, kill someone, and then the funeral will have them celebrating again just to do it all over again. What a wild life these Vikings lived.
Number 5, drunk sword fighting and other things. Imagine letting a 2-year-old hold a very sharp broadsword. Sounds like a bad idea, right? Well, nobody seemed to think so when they put swords in the hands of drunk Vikings, which, let's be honest, that's pretty much what a 2-year-old is essentially like a drunk person walking around. Outdoors, Vikings constantly wanted to one-up each other on the strength meter. They had weightlifting competitions, who could lift the heaviest stones, they wrestled, held archery contests, and of course sword fighting competitions, as well as all the games Bree mentioned above. Were they sober? Probably not. They also had a game called Togo Honk, which was kind of like tug of war. Men would sit on the ground facing one another, press their feet together, and bend their knees. The goal was to try to straighten your opponent's legs and flip him over. Honestly? That sounds like a blast. Do you think it's a smart idea to put a sword in a drunk guy's hand? No, but it was the Viking era. There were literally no rules except for a few.
At number 4, not enough chairs. Now we know that these Viking celebrations would often last for days on end, right? So imagine if during all that time you couldn't sit anywhere comfortable. Sounds pretty unfortunate, but it was the reality of a lot of Viking parties. Because these gatherings were so big, hundreds of people would be in attendance, but unfortunately there wouldn't be enough space to sit. To try and accommodate their hundreds of guests, Vikings would break out their longest tables and benches, but usually this still wasn't enough space for everyone, so it became kind of a rule that only the most important people were allowed to sit. Chairs are thought to have been pretty rare, so the most powerful and wealthiest Vikings were allowed to sit in chairs. Everyone else had to fend for themselves, either sitting on uncomfortable benches or just standing around. Now, doing this for a couple of hours? No problem. For a 2-week celebration? You can count me the heck out. If my tushy's not comfortable, I'm going home.
Number 3, fertility celebrations. So we talked a lot about what Vikings actually did back then and how they partied. They partied pretty hard. But now we're talking about what kind of festivals they had. This holiday is celebrated on April 30th in Finland, Sweden, and Germany, but goes all the way back to the Vikings. This night is called Valburgis Night, or Valburgis Night, or I probably said it wrong, but let me know. And is named after a woman called Valborg. She was born in 710 somewhere in Dorset/Wessex as the niece of St. Boniface. She traveled with her brothers to Württemberg, Germany, and became a nun. She lived in a convent of Heidenheim and became renowned for her healing powers and was canonized as a saint after she died. This celebration is in honor of her, however it was originally a pagan celebration called Beltane, a celebration of the return of summer. Viking fertility celebrations took place in and around April 30th, and due to Valborg claiming this date as well, the two celebrations became one and the same eventually. Viking fertility celebrations usually involved sacrificing an animal or two of some kind, and included all of the above.
At number 2, harvest/winter night celebration. Next up in celebrations to mark on your calendar, we have the harvest/winter night that took place on October 31st. It can also be referred to as elf blessing, dis blessing, or Frey blessing. Kind of like our spooky tradition today, it was a time of honoring the ancestral spirits, spirits of the land, the Vanir, along with the powers of fruitfulness, wisdom, and of course, death. A little brutal, yet kind of merciful in a way, the animals who weren't going to be able to make it through the winter were smoked or made into sausage. It was often led by the women of the household. They left the last sheep in the field as an offering to Odin, though this varies. It also marks the start of something called the Wild Hunt. The roads and fields became territory of ghosts and trolls and marks the beginning of the darkest and coldest time of the year. The festivities and feasts are particularly joyous, and they mainly aim to celebrate kinship, accomplishments, and the tales of the year.
Last but not least, Yule. This last one is perfect for the season we are entering and a great way to end the list. The festival of Yule was, slash kind of, still is, a celebration of 12 days. It was the most important of all Norse holidays and began on the night of December 20th. The god Yngvi Freyr rides over the earth on the back of his shining boar, bringing light and love back into the world. Later, Christianity influenced things, changing the god to Baldur, then Jesus, who said to be reborn at the festival. For the Vikings, Yule signified the beginning and end of all things, taking place at the darkest time of the year. Children were said to leave their boots outside, filled with hay and sugar, for the god's journey, and in return they would receive a little present. Sound familiar? On top of that, the celebration would include drinking, feasting, songs, games, banquets, and sacrifices to the gods and the ancestor spirits for the 12 days. They even had what was called a Yule tree, which inspired the use of the Christmas tree today.
And that was our list of the top 10 unusual things that happened in Viking celebration.
Do any of you have some crazy stories wilder than the Vikings? I doubt it, but tell us in the comments anyway. I've been your host, Rachel Fisher.
And I've been Bree Room. And until next time,
stay sweet bees.